to thank the Treasury for inviting me to make a contribution after 13 years' absence from any involvement in public life. It's been a welcome challenge to re-immerse myself in issues with which I used to be familiar. The paper I've contributed doesn't have this title. It's entitled Long-Term Fiscal Risks New Zealand's Face in the Context of OECD Countries. And there's lots of cross-country comparisons compiled in the paper with the help of James Beard of the Treasury and Michelle Harding, formerly of the Treasury, but both in Paris, and I'm indebted to them for their help. It's a long paper, and I'm not going to trawl through all the comparisons. There's not time. And in any case, many of the cross-country comparisons have come out in the course of the conference. So instead, I'd like to focus on the main theme of the paper, which is about seeing this fiscal review as an exercise in managing a wider range of risks under conditions of significant uncertainty, and modestly how, from a political point of view, one might seek to stop the need for fiscal prudence sliding off the radar screen. Now, Sir Michael's paper makes many wise observations about the political economy of these issues that I share. He finished up on superannuation, in which he's well qualified to speak on. I'd like to just go back to a wider horizon. And I'm sorry I'm reading this speech, it's a thing I never do, but your time constraint has made me very nervous. But in theory, this should take 28 minutes to turn to the page, and I've got markers all the way through it, so I hope it works. But the issues we're dealing with are broader than retirement income, and they're subject to pervasive uncertainties that really could do with some underlining. Because, you know, the issue of retirement income places the demographic transition we're undergoing in sharp relief. And the fact that the trajectory of ageing can be so precisely quantified, and then the impact model, is one of the lines Michael set up there, lends a misleading sense of certainty to this whole debate. The phenomenon is painted as inexorable, quantifiable, and manageable. And of course, in one sense, it is. But we should also reflect on how unfamiliar the future might be. The world has never experienced ageing on the scale we're about to live through. This is what it means for the old age support ratio in OECD countries. It's only got three slides, and this is in the paper if you want to look at it. But you can see the decline the countries are ranked, and New Zealand, like all OECD countries, is up against this. And this is what the ageing means fiscally in a variety of countries. And there we are, if you add together pensions, health, and long-term care, as a share of GDP, you've got New Zealand going from under 15 to 23, but it's the same across the board. So we're in this together, folks, with lots of other people. But it's not just a developed country phenomenon. China will shortly start to age before ever having fully developed. And that aging will occur in the most urban world we've ever experienced. I mean, you realise, don't you, 1950, 30% urban, 70% rural at the global level. 2050, 70% urban, 30% rural. That is just a staggering transition of the way as a species that we're living. And absent political or biological disaster, and you can't discount those, it will also be the most mobile world we've ever lived in. And that raises profound issues about identity. Now, you all know this, we all know this, but we don't really understand what it will entail, which is why I feel instinctively nervous about telling people that we can engineer particular outcomes. Geopolitical, social, and environmental trends mean that the world in which future taxes and dividends are struck will differ significantly from the context in which current entitlements have been established. And while we can describe the plausible direction of a number of these trends, the risks around them are not sensibly quantifiable. It doesn't mean they can be ignored. Now, take the physical environment, and that's the field that I work in. A much larger economy will place increasing pressure on the planet's capacity to absorb waste and supply vital ecosystem services. Our model, the model that my team work with, has just done an outlook to 2050. It projects that the global economy, on a no policy change basis, will sail effortlessly from $75 trillion to $300 trillion. The OECD's share of the global economy will decline from a little over half GDP, at 54%, to less than a third. And needless to say, New Zealand becomes an even more vanishingly small element of a much less familiar geopolitical world. the global environmental pressures of such a world, whose impacts will be transmitted directly, as in the case of climate change, or indirectly through declining environmental quality affecting global supply chains. Our baseline case projects that the world, for your information, is on course for 3 to 6 degrees warming by the end of the century, 55% increase in demand for water, with 40% of the world's population living in areas of severe water stress, further 10% decline in biodiversity, and a doubling of the number of premature deaths from airborne pollution, principally particulate and ground level ozone. And of course, in OECD countries, we're particularly prone to that because an aging population is much more susceptible to airborne pollution. That happens in every country in the world. It's not just China. This is a Europe, New Zealand, Australia problem. So, as an open economy, New Zealand can expect to feel the consequences of rising resource scarcity and environmental damage through trade linkages and directly experience the local consequences of things like globally induced climate change. Depending on the severity of environmental pressures, New Zealand could become an increasingly desirable destination for migrants, as well as benefit from demand for the biological output of its resources in a world needing more food. Now, the global scale of potential climate change has reinforced the impression that environmental change is the most likely sort of catastrophic risk. This may not be so. And if you want a carefully measured assessment of the relative orders of magnitude that can reasonably be attached to known risks, Vaclav Smil is an absolutely essential reading. Now retired, University of Manitoba, Czech, SKP in 1968, an engineer, polymath, amazing guy. On the basis of a rigorous assessment of the known statistical level of exposure to risk of fatality caused by large-scale catastrophic events, Smil identifies only one risk emanating from the natural world for the next 50 years. That's a viral pandemic to which he would ascribe a high probability of mortalities in the region of 10 to the power of 5. So that's the one, and he ascribes a similar level of probability to a mega war defined as potentially massive armed confrontation. Now, conflict, as we know, isn't good for smoothly advancing prosperity. And to those inclined to dismiss such risks, Smil counsels pondering on the ubiquity throughout history of irrationality, the drive for power and dominance, and how as a species we might respond to unpleasant social and environmental developments. And if you think about this, he says, you might be there to conclude, and I quote, that despite many localized problems, the second half of the 20th century was an exceptionally stable and an unusually benign period in global terms, and that the probabilities of more painful events will greatly increase during the next 50 years. Then there are natural hazards. New Zealand's vulnerability to seismic and volcanic events is well known. I don't need to mention them in this city. Natural disasters have the potential to impose economic shocks that knock New Zealand's growth prospects and thereby undermine the government's ability to raise tax revenue. Prudentially, New Zealand's geological endowment requires the government to run its finances on the basis that it will have to face recurrent fiscal burdens. Michael made this point. In the same way that countries like the Netherlands face water management expenditures, or other countries face significant defence expenditures for geopolitical reasons. A similar reasoning applies to New Zealand's relatively high exposure to biological risk, given the biological basis of the economy. Now, while not a natural disaster in the same sense, anthropogenic climate change poses unknown, but potentially significant economic risks within the horizon under the consideration of this exercise. Significant climate change is already locked in, and global emissions trajectory suggests the chances of holding average global temperature increases to 2 degrees are fast evaporating. The global community faces a choice in the next decade of either acquiescing in significant climatic disruption or costly adjustment because of the failure to take comprehensive measures over the last 20 years. You pay either way. Like many countries, New Zealand's stated acknowledgement of the risks is not matched by actions that can significantly reduce such risks. While the costs of placing economies at a competitive disadvantage from acting unilaterally are prominently advertised, the costs of a collective failure to act are discounted. This is a long-run challenge that I don't think will go away, and the costs that will be encountered either adapting to the consequences or trying in a rush to limit their extent are likely to weigh on future growth. That places a further question mark for me over future growth scenarios, my 75 to 300 trillion, which are based on benign assumptions about the physical world, or actually no assumptions. One other class of risk to smoothly advancing prosperity deserves comment, and that's financial crises. The financial sector is capable of delivering shocks with every bit as much impact as natural disasters. Such shocks can swiftly impose constraints on a government's fiscal position for many years. Economic crises are not rare events. A recent study, very recent study, estimates that since 1970, there have been a total of 147 banking crises, 218 currency crises, and 66 sovereign debt crises. As the world's now well aware, this is not just an emerging markets phenomenon. 31 of the 34 current OECD members have experienced at least one systemic banking crisis since 1970, and 32 have experienced at least one of a banking, currency, or sovereign debt crisis over that period. Against this backdrop, New Zealand is indeed fortunate not to have been among those having experienced a banking crisis. Although this may be as much a consequence of prudent Australian regulation governing our largely Australian-owned banking sector. Serial failures, and that's the only word I can find, serial failures by other New Zealand financial intermediaries over the last 30 years have destroyed a significant share of private savings, which suggests that New Zealand has lacked important management skills and has failed to regulate appropriately. So there's no room for complacency on that one. One specific source of economic vulnerability for New Zealand is its external indebtedness position and the risk of a sudden stop in capital inflows if foreigners turn New Zealand off as an investment destination. Now, encouraged by New Zealand's economic performance and prospects, sound institutions and policy settings, and good marketing, foreign investors have been willing to fund New Zealand's sustained current account deficit. This has seen the net national international investment position expand to a net liability of over 70% of GDP. Good management, bipartisan track record of taking unpalatable political decisions when required, has shielded New Zealand from greater investor scepticism. But it cannot be assumed to be indefinitely unshakable. A significant and sustained negative reappraisal of New Zealand's risk profile could see GDP and employment fall as activity contracts, and the fiscal position deteriorate. Only our institutions, including this one we're all involved in today, and political probity keep those prospects at bay. Now, New Zealand's policymakers aren't alone in pondering what long-run trends mean for fiscal sustainability. The demography of OECD countries, coupled with the rapidly increasing economic weight of emerging economies, means they're all beginning to face competition for capital, resources, and skills from a much less advantageous position than they have been accustomed to for a century. What distinguishes New Zealand from many OECD countries is the fact that this inquiry is not taking place in response to an immediate fiscal crisis or economic crisis, but as part of an institutionalised process of periodic review. This, combined with the relative intimacy of New Zealand society and its less polarised political landscape, should enable a more measured trimming of the fiscal sails in advance of acute challenges arising. Whether or not this happens is, of course, another matter. New Zealand's relative security has led to long periods of policy immobilism, which nevertheless seem to be surmounted when a crisis threatens. The crisis of the 1980s led to a remarkable policy response and the expenditure, let's be frank, of a huge amount of political capital in terms of trust in political institutions, and rebuilding that trust has been a slow, hard-won business. The temptation now then is to consolidate rather than take action, but I put it to you that the future is less accommodating than it was 30 years ago. New Zealand was one of the first OECD economies to promote a radical break with the post-war mixed economy consensus. While all OECD countries faced difficulties in the aftermath of the oil shocks of the 1970s, the crisis of public finances in New Zealand was exceptional. Structural reform to promote growth played into a global economic outlook that, while difficult, was not plagued by the synchronised resort to austerity measures currently being experienced. There was room for a small open economy to exploit growth opportunities in a global marketplace that was expanding as trade barriers fell. So difficult structural adjustment could be pursued in a less demanding global climate. And of course, many of our OECD partners still had relatively strong national balance sheets then. In addition, a demographic window was opening in which the demand for spending on the school-aged cohort was moderated without any immediate increase in the population of retirees. Reversing an exceptionally low age of pension entitlement also managed to defer the worsening of the old age dependency ratio by 7 or 8 years. And my speed needs means I can now delay my delivery a little because I'm ahead of trajectory. That window, those more benign circumstances, that window has now closed. New Zealand faces the need to keep public debt levels under control and ensure that sound policy supports continued access to global capital markets by New Zealand businesses against the backdrop of the world's worst economic recession in two generations and worsening demographic trends. Now, retirement income has been a particular lightning rod. Because the decision to pay pensions out of taxes relies on expenditure decisions that will be voted by elected officials far in the future, no one can say with certainty how a future parliament will regard any intergenerational bargain purportedly made on its behalf decades before its own election. And can I say, all of you young people put your hands up and said, won't be there when I get there, I see exactly that at your age. I mean, it goes almost with the patch. How can you possibly rely on what somebody standing there is telling you is going to happen in 40 years' time? The fact is that we do muddle through, and I suspect some sort of more or less painful muddle through may be what will occur. But to say, no, it won't be there, you just can't say that. You just can't say that. Just like you can't say it will be there exactly like it is now. I just don't think you can talk in those terms. Encouragement of savings provides a way for people to spread the risks by relying not just on future taxpayers, but on returns from privately invested capital. But again, that's not without risk. 30 or 40 years from now, as savers set out to call in their annuities, they will, with retirees all around the world, find themselves in competition with relatively fewer workers whose bargaining position will be stronger, and the owners of industry whose views about dividend payments may not match those of pension fund managers. Now, can I ask the same thing, people, put your hand up if returns to savings, and by the time you get there, will definitely be there as you're told they will. That's strange. Strange asymmetry in response. You don't think they will be, and you don't think super will, so God help us. A more numerous retired population might be expected to secure the election of a parliament that represents its interests. And Michael's point is a very powerful one about the electoral politics of this. But elections are an extremely imperfect mechanism for securing particular preferences. In deciding on the level and incidence of taxation, politicians are at the centre of a contest between the only partially overlapping interests of the owners of capital, seeking dividends, workers seeking remunerations, and voters wanting taxes spent on them. The outcome of the particular forces at work in some future economic and political setting is simply unknowable. I'm sorry, it's not comfortable, but it's unknowable. And all one can say is that for today's working age population to assume that rising claims on taxpayers will be met in the future on the basis of current sentiment would be very risky, and that's where the young people here are right to be sceptical. Now, the most cautious way, Michael mentioned a view on super, I'll mention an even more cautious one. That wasn't cautious, by the way. The most cautious way to minimise these risks on super would be through a phased increase in the age of eligibility to match increasing life expectancy. It's happening in some OECD countries, I think it will become universal. A more ambitious approach would, in addition, consider elements of targeting. And you might even dabble with progressively, out in the future, lowering the relationship with wages. And then you'd have to communicate the desirability of savings, and you'd be back into some sort of safety net. Now, my views on this are not important, but I think we know the sort of alternatives that are out there. But retirement income is only one driver of the emerging fiscal pressures, and it would be unfortunate if this review process becomes all about retirement income. It's the wider bundle of services that needs to be considered, and just as importantly, the resilience of the economy and the tax system to meet the claims that are likely to be made by politicians in the future. Taking a wider view would lead one to focus as much concern on the apparently inexorable increase in foreign claims on output through accumulating balance of payments deficits as particular government expenditure trends. As net borrowers, New Zealanders face the real possibility that not only governments may not be able to deliver the social dividends they hope for, but that access to capital needed to generate new income streams may be significantly limited. An optimistic forward-looking scenario would see global demographic trends as ultimately playing into New Zealand's hands. So this is the good news for a moment. A world of 2 billion more inhabitants, little more than a generation, and widespread demand for more food on the part of a growing middle class, many plays New Zealand's strengths as a food producer. Well, that may be so. And in that case, the rents from increasingly scarce soil and water might be sufficient to sustain rising living standards into the future. I think the interesting political economy question, if you argue that, is whether food producers should be allowed to keep the full benefits of those rents. I think that the case for taxing the rents that soil, water and other resources provide cannot be ignored in a world where capital and labour are so mobile. You need tax bases that will still be there, and of course a world in which resources will be much scarcer. And to this optimistic story might be added New Zealand's geopolitical proximity to the region where the largest growth prospects are clustered, China and East Asia. I hear New Zealanders say it's up in the flight of China tonight. I've never thought it was geopolitically close, but still, it seems reasonably safe to assume an ongoing rise in Chinese influence in both economic and security spheres. But how far that influence will extend and with what consequences for a tiny trading country like New Zealand is simply impossible to say. China faces a multitude of long-term challenges that place a question mark over the inevitability of its ascent. An extraordinarily aberrant gender ratio, serious environmental ills, the increasing inequality of economic rewards, and its weak soft power appeal. These risks and uncertainties provide a compelling rationale for placing public finances in this country on a more resilient basis. And I think this review is just brilliantly timed, because New Zealand is neither so rich, say like Norway, that it isn't under pressure, nor so fragile that it's forced to take precipitate action. Many OECD countries are being forced to take steps that are ad hoc and brutal. A meeting at the OECD last week on health noted that where were cuts being made in health? Primary health care. That's not where you make the cuts if you were taking a strategic view, you didn't have somebody at your back, but that's what is starting to happen. New Zealand has for the moment the opportunity to act preemptively on its own terms rather than in response to external pressures. But that relatively benign position will not last. The opportunity should be grasped so that change isn't precipitate and citizens and taxpayers can adjust their circumstances with time to spare. Now, if that is to happen, we have to turn a deaf ear to some apparently easy solutions. And over the years, a variety of painless remedies have been offered as alternatives to either curbing expenditure or raising taxes, or both, to generate the surpluses needed to reduce the stock of debt. The most seductive one is to advocate higher rates of growth that will lift all boats, including government revenues. And this is alive and well. This is the resort argument that people fall back on. There are two problems with this approach. In the first place, there is actually no historic record of the New Zealand economy sustaining a rate of growth higher than 2%. But even if such a growth rate were achieved, there is absolutely no way of ensuring a significant share of higher tax revenues could be devoted to debt retirement. Growth brings with it rising expectations and ensuing distributional claims. That's the reality of politics. So Michael made that point very well. An alternative remedy often advocated is a much more aggressive inward migration policy. Not enough people here. Build up the population. There's a belief that a much larger population would underwrite higher productivity. And to the extent that we can count on large numbers of younger skilled migrants of working age, a more productive workforce might seem a plausible outcome. But again, there are no guarantees. New Zealand cannot assume that it will be able to attract the people it thinks it wants. Now, we've had 25,000 or more net migrants in only four of the past 60 years. It doesn't occupy, New Zealand doesn't occupy a global crossroads. It can't position itself as some sort of global emporium. Many other economies can offer higher densities of intellectual capital and more exciting opportunities. Fly for 2.5 hours and all you get to is Sydney. human capital is, for me, the Achilles heel of New Zealand's future ability to stay afloat. Currently, we're managing to cover the outward migration of skills with a matching inflow, and that's what this slide shows. Immigrants from other OECD countries, immigrants to other OECD countries, immigrants from the rest of the world, and the net. And you can see we're in balance. It's very simple. If the human capital pipeline were disrupted, I'd say all bets are off. You can't just assume people want to come and live here. But even if we could significantly outcompete other countries for human capital, it's not a sustainable answer. Migrants can't be held at arm's length from the matrix of expectations and services that drive public expenditures. Migrants will demand health and education services like everyone else, and it's fair to say they also age. So a larger, more vibrant population would very likely contribute to productivity growth, but whether it would be sufficient to reverse the public debt trajectory is another matter. So how do we make progress from here? Sorry about that. Let's turn off, it's a huge distraction. What I do? Go back.
B.
What's that?
B.
B. We're into injury time too. I'll leave it up there. Don't look at it, it's very distracting. I want to finish by asking then, how do we make progress from here? Well, the political conditions for making progress will be optimised if the factual boundaries of the policy debate can be broadly agreed and interpreted. These boundaries cannot encompass strongly normative propositions. A very large element of public policy debate is about the distributional consequences of policy change. And that's as true of debates over regulatory reform and property rights as it is about taxing and spending decisions. These are evergreen debates. They won't go away. It's what Western democracies are about. But it should be possible to agree that any solution being proffered by parties can't ignore certain facts. Elected officials could make a constructive contribution to New Zealand's future by accepting that policy options are constrained by the following propositions I have said. First, without policy change, demographic momentum will drive the current fiscal imbalance even further from balance with a consequent build-up in the stock of public debt. Two, recourse to policies designed to enhance productivity, i.e. grow our way out, however desirable, cannot alone be relied upon to close the spending gap. Three, there are sufficient risks, nationally and globally, to assert that the climate for fiscal consolidation in the future is unlikely to be more benign than it is today. Four, recent events confirm that sovereign borrowers enjoy no special immunity from the requirement of everyone ultimately to live within their means, and that low debt levels are essential if governments are to retain the firepower necessary to respond to costly, unforeseen, disjunctive events. Five, expenditure control and tax increases in whatever proportions are the only certain ways of generating the surpluses needed to bring the stock of debt down to a level at which that sovereign firepower can be protected. Six, returning to fiscal balance and reducing debt is best done outside of a crisis context, and an agreement on a trajectory and timetable need not preclude a vigorous debate about how to stay on that trajectory. That's the distributional debate. And seven, given that policy changes are likely to hold spending and taxing consequences that differ across generations, being able to communicate a clear long-term trajectory is not only more economically efficient, it's also fairer. It's fairer to be transparent rather than leave the future permanently veiled in uncertainty. Now, if a multi-party consensus around boundaries, fact horizons, if you like, of this type can be agreed by the political establishment, then New Zealanders could turn their mind to the range of policy alternatives that are on offer. Confidence that their long-term security, if not guaranteed, was at least being debated and argued within responsible bounds. So you will ask, what are the chances of agreement on boundaries today being respected in debate tomorrow? And it's here that some institutional innovation might be useful. The current exercise led by the Treasury has been both sophisticated in its reach and ecumenical in its invited participation. But it has inevitably engaged a policy literate elite, and the Treasury, which serves the government of the day, cannot be on permanent referee duties for the community as a whole. It's on referee duties for the government of the day. So for that reason, it might be worth conferring the guardianship of the debate to an independent entity that can comment directly on the consistency of policy settings with the agreed need to keep debt and expenditure on sustainable tracks. I don't think that needs to be an expensive or cumbersome business. The Treasury could, through an amendment to the Public Finance Act, be charged with annually assessing the trajectory of policies currently in place against pre-agreed criteria for fiscal sustainability. That analysis could be made available to an independent fiscal sustainability committee whose job it would be to provide a public commentary on the compatibility of policy settings with desired long-run outcomes. The appointment, tenure, and public outreach of such a committee to secure its independence and authority is beyond the scope of either the paper I have written or the comments I'm making today. Colin James's paper canvasses a range of institutional possibilities, and I agree with him when he says that New Zealand's record as a public policy innovator should give us some confidence that new approaches could be found. That said, politicians, notably absent from this conference, have been jealous about infringements on the exercise of executive power. And the fact that New Zealand remains a unicameral system with far fewer moving parts than most democracies is evidence for this. The control of fiscal policy lies at the heart of executive power in New Zealand, and going beyond formal scrutiny to some form of limitation or review would indeed be novel. Let me just conclude by saying that the current exercise provides more than enough evidence that prudence demands credible and durable responses to the fiscal consequences of demographic, financial, and geopolitical trends. We don't need any more papers on the dynamics that compel this conclusion. What we need now, I think, is sustained attention to the conditions that will permit our political institutions to deliver those responses.